Dog would have been probably another one during that
period. Terry would have been, and Dick was in the mine. Now, I'm talking the older Dick, not Richard.
Correct, yeah, we interviewed him.
Yeah, and they would all be good at telling you the mine stories, because the mine is, you know, it's totally a place of its own. And all the time that I worked, of course it is union, all the time that I worked, the mine is, you only got to go to the mine when you had a lot of seniority. It was the favorite job, because the temperature is always the same. And like the guy said, they didn't have as many people that were watching over them. they were kind of independent, you know, of the above ground. As long as they made their tonnage, why they, you know, they had a pretty good working spot.
Do you remember what your salary was when you were hired on?
No, I don't. I should look that up for you. It was really big.
I bet.
I don't have any idea. You know, I'm guessing, because when I was in Manhattan at the insurance company before I got married, which brought me back to the county, I think I got $90, and I don't think this probably was much more than that. I don't really remember, but I'm sure it was around that.
Then you had pretty good benefits.
Yes, they had excellent benefits.
Did they have the picnics for the group back then when you first started?
No, that's been a later thing. They have picnics, and of course the 25-year dinner came into play when a lot of the people that came to work in 1960 got to 25 years. They decided to do that for them, and they are still doing that. It will be next Thursday night over at Barnes. They're still doing the 25-year dinner plus, but most of us got 30, 35, 40, you know, years before we quit. But so I guess I don't know anything else to tell you, unless you guys have some questions. Of course, after I was there for a while, as you would, you moved up, and when I retired, I was the chief accountant and the office manager at Blue Rapids. We did a lot of traveling to the other plants in the division for training. We helped out with anything we could that way, and we even did quite a bit of traveling to Atlanta to the home office. We had a division that always made money for the corporation, but the Blue Rapids, Kansas plant always supported the division. If they lost money, we held them up and still showed a profit. And basically that's because we have the purest gypsum deposit. We made the most of our things were industrial plasters to us. And they're used in so many things, I don't know how to begin to tell you what all, but some of my favorites when I first started to work that I thought, oh, one of them was toothpaste. I thought, oh, so much for that toothpaste. of course, they poured plate glass on it. It's bullet shell filler, just flooring. There's just immediate.
Molds.
Oh, yeah. But there's just so many things it's used for. And so our profit would always be high, and the other plants basically concentrated a lot on wallboard because of their gypsum. It wasn't as pure as ours. So, but sometimes they'd be making lots of money on wallboard, but it's a little bit like the housing market is. It was up and down. Sometimes you could sell it for anything you wanted, and the next time for way under what it cost you to make it. So, forgot what else we might
have. Now, you said one time you visited in Las Vegas.
Oh, yeah. We did. We did go to a lot of the plants. A couple of us spent quite a bit of time in Las Vegas. Charlie Repke, for one, and myself went out and did a lot of training in Las Vegas when they first opened it, because it was one of our newer plants. The others, a lot of those had already been in operation. When we went out there, it was an interesting training, because they hired so many people that could not read or write. And for Charlie and I, this was kind of hard. Every order that they gave them had to be color marked. One color stood for one product, another color for another. It was difficult. They were trying really hard, but they just simply didn't know English. A lot of, you know, Hispanic and other population. But we did spend quite a bit of time out at the Las Vegas plant, and it's one of our newer ones. It had an interesting story of its own when it was being built. We thought we would never get it built because we had it almost done, and the people came in and said, you can't build there because this is a turtle run. This is where the turtles migrate to mate, and so you cannot do it there. So they had to tear a lot of it down, and they had to build runways under the plant so that the turtles could stay on their regular runway. Cost, naturally, a lot of money. But it did finally get off the ground, and it's a successful plant, and it's operating today. It was closed for a while, but it's back in operation.
Did you see turtles?
No.
Using the runway?
No, all the time I was out there, I thought, this really looks ridiculous, but we had no choice. But a lot of people from Blue Rapids have gone out there, you know, and helped them get started.
And the type of mining that they do there?
It's not underground, like shaft, like ours is shaft and completely underground. It's more like rock mining. They take dirt off and they go down to it, and maybe strip mining it. They've got a word for it, which I've forgotten what it is. But there's this, and it has to be hauled out of the mountains down to the plant. So it has a lot of expense incurred in their gypsum. They basically do a lot of the different wallboard types, not much industrial plaster. And I'm sure that's still true.
Okay, this would be a super sack that Bonnie Feldhausen told us that's what it was. And some of them are huge. This must be the area where they put the gypsum down in. And here's a little compartment here that opens up. Don't know how it really works, but that's called a super sack. Here, and this was switchboard used in the CertainTe office prior to the fire, destroyed the plant in 1960. And Bonnie Feldhausen told us about how it worked and her job running that. This would be the picture of the plant done over here that burned in August of 1960. And we have a variety of people in the plant, different years, some of the older miners. And like Ben Mauld is in some of the pictures. Colonel Davis. Inside the mine and the carts. Those are the CertainTe plant. A lot of these are along in here. Orville Thomas and Oscar Weir. United States Gypsum plant sign. Not sure where that came from, do you? Okay. Then all along the top, we have all these sacks, the industrial plaster sacks, and the different functions for each of them, floor underlayment and the molding plaster, pottery, the industrial plaster. And then here's the plant that was out on Dr. Dunsing's property out south of town, the long skinny picture. These two are the plant that burned down, best wall by the Narrows. Then we have helmets, and we have different people have donated helmets. And back here on this back wall, we have a map showing all the different locations and the dates of the gypsum plants around Blue Rapids. And this was 1960 up here on the very top. That was the new plant, and since then they've added to it. So we need to have another aerial sometime. Over here is the mural that Kenny Winkenwaiter did for the Chamber of Commerce. This would be the new best wall plant. The rock one would be one of them. Great Western Plaster, maybe, company. And there's a mule coming out of the tunnel. Lunchroom guys, can you see those? The guys down in the lunchroom, right there. And then Oscar Weir's over there on the very far corner. Oh, and then here's Alan Svoboda, too, up here, filling a sack. Maybe that's one of the super sacks. You know, they were brown back then. Frank Balderson, he was in the packing of the gypsum sacks. Ivan Warders, Bob Pullen, and a certain tea plant. And then down in our showcase, we have products.
There's a nice one here, the dedication of the plant, the new plant.
For this breathing filter mask for many years while he worked down in the mine. And then there's the two carbide lanterns that the guys used on top of their helmet. And satin spar, which comes from the plant, or from the mine. Then here's some products that you can make out of some of the different types of plaster. And we've got a variety of rocks down on the very bottom that came out of the mine. They're labeled. Some of them are rather pretty.
And some assorted magazines and certificates, mostly from Dick Spoonoggle. Tell us about this object of art here.
Okay, it's a raw gypsum rock that was mounted on a refined plaster of Paris mold, and Orville Thomas did those as doorstops, and I think he gave them away as gifts to his family and friends. And I'm sure it would keep the door in one spot. Pretty heavy.